Hello, Data Vaulters. Welcome to our series of presentations providing an orientation to Datavault 2. This is a seven-part series, and this video is part 3, where we explore the layer architecture of the Datavault 2 solution. Layers are very much a part of all data warehouse methods. Each layer represents a hop, processing and moving data from one state into another. If we have a big data project, for example, we want to minimize hops for speed and to reduce costs. The core part of a Datavault 2 design is the raw vault. This contains raw source data processed to cluster around key business entities. So, for example, product may be a key entity, and product-related raw data from different sources is extracted and joined to a product entity or hub. The raw vault is where hubs, links, and satellites are used, but more about those later. A staging layer is used to bring data from external sources or files into the raw vault database for onward processing. Stage data is truncated each load, it's transient. Traditionally, data feed is batched, but today we can have a mix of streams data, micro-batched, and batched data feeds. The raw vault holds all the data, but consumers want access to a subset of this for their own purposes. They may want the data in a particular format or tuned for certain types of query, and there are data privacy and security concerns. A MART layer is used to extract a subset of the raw vault and to meet the needs of end users and our data policies. There isn't just one MART. Data in the raw vault can be used by many different groups across the organization. We create a separate MART for each distinct group. As data comes from one source, the raw vault, it will reconcile no matter which MART you take it from. Finally, we may need to apply some business rules to perform standard calculations, to clean or normalize data, or to derive new data. This data is stored in a business vault, overlaid on and sharing the database with the raw vault. This is the classic layer structure, but it's not that commonly used today. In the classic layer structure, data files are loaded to staging before load to the raw vault, then the data is truncated. But what happens to the original files? Are they worth keeping? A data lake layer is commonly added to persist these feed files, and to assemble streams as well. This has three advantages. Files can be replayed at any time, so if we make an error, we can drop the affected data and reload. We can decide to process only a partial set of data and come back later for more. And we can connect Hive to the file system, hook up a visualization tool, and treat it as an operational data store. These are very powerful benefits and reduce unnecessary hops. In many organizations, there are additional layers inside the data lake to receive, verify, and quarantine data before it's added to the lake. As the business rules engine generates new data, it is also treated as a data source just like any other, so it feeds data to the lake as well for cycling back into the vault through the regular load pattern. Data streaming is added. This can stream data into the data lake for a later batch load to the raw vault, or it can feed directly into the raw vault, such as into a partitioned append-only table. Some examples of this have achieved impressive load rates. As the data warehouse matures, we'll want to use its data for a number of downstream use cases. Traditionally, we have reporting or visualization via a dashboard. These tend to hold a local cache of data or share a central cache taken from the MART. But we may want to work on data and then save the results. Perhaps we are doing a forecast or a budget. This is new data to be added to the data lake. Self-service BI must have this write-back functionality to close the loop. We may want to build an API over the MART, or develop a downstream interface or extract, and these are easy to do with cloud services. we can now extend the raw vault. We can store metadata, data about the vault and data flows. For example, data about quality metrics, volumes, data feed success rates and service levels. We can also store an error mart. This holds data that fails load to the raw vault and can be investigated to find more data quality problems or to diagnose bugs. And finally, we can add a catalogue. This can offer search functionality and a glossary. It would point to the sources of data within the lake, mart or vault layers that matches business keywords. Datavault 2 loads are designed to run as much in parallel and as fast as possible. This is the norm, but sometimes we can't avoid dependencies. We want to avoid foreign key enforcement, sequence numbers, and reference table lookups as much as possible. Now, this is achieved by using derived primary keys, commonly a hashing algorithm, but other approaches will also work. Handling data at volume is difficult. As volumes grow, some data strategies, such as indexing, become progressively more expensive to maintain. We need to reduce hops, so we might stream data straight into the raw vault, an approach that works successfully for some, or just use the data vault for a smaller subset of data for reporting purposes, leaving the rest in the lake for bulk processing. That's the challenge we all face as architects. Well, in summary, the Datavault 2 method has a base layer called the raw vault. There are some patterns out there with a data lake and data marts and other layers that you might want to copy. But in the end, it is an architecture you can flex to meet your own project's requirements. Datavault 2 has standards that support scalability. You should follow them as closely as you can. If you need to get hold of more detailed information, you can download user group presentations from the user group website. We also offer Datavault 2 and information governance related blogs and white papers from our company site. These are all worth checking out. Thanks for viewing this video. See you in the next.